Welcome, Dragon Champions, to another Dragon Law Gaming Presents Dragon Champions. I appreciate you guys being here. The growth of the channel is great. If you are new around here, hit that subscribe button. Help us. We're pushing, trying to get to that 1,000 subscriber mark. Things are going really, really well. Next goal is to 200, so I really do appreciate you guys. Today, what we're going to talk about is a tier guide with the new patch that came out. The new patch that happened, the 1.1.18 patch, things have changed, right? We now know better who's good and who's not because of the nerfs that happened and that sort of stuff. I decided to create a new tier list. This new tier list is going to have four tiers to it. We're going to have tier 1, tier 2, tier 3, and tier 4. Tier 1 characters, and that's what we're going to talk about today, is the tier 1 characters. Tier 1 characters are tier 1 for the following reasons. They're tier 1 because they are good, standalone characters that can be implemented into anywhere in the game and be viable. And not just viable, but amazing. And as you can see right now on the top of the screen, these are it. You have basically these top 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 characters. The top 8 characters, Nidiel, Kara, Solius, Freezard, Trumgard, Wonderlula, Patriarch Chi, and Hardorc. They are your top tier characters, these top 8. And we're going to go through them one by one and explain to you why I think that these characters are the best characters currently in the game, and they're in the top tier. Top tier, how I define top tier, once again, are standalone characters that can be plugged and played into any part of the game. We're talking PvP, PvE, arena, tower, campaign, anywhere. They are amazing characters that allow for you to go into any game mode tournaments, right? So let's look at the different game modes, right? So obviously we can break the game down into PvE and PvP. I think that's pretty basic. I think we need to go a step further than that, and we need to look at, are they good in tournaments if they're available? Are they good in the challenges, right? Are they good in the raid? Are they good in arena? Are they good in tower, right? I think that we could break them all down that way, and I do plan on doing that. This is, like I said, this is a series that's going to happen, but we're going to talk about the top tier, number one, the top eight characters in the game, and the reason for that, because they can be played anywhere. When you can use them in tournaments, you can use them in tournaments. When you can use them in the events, you can use them in the events, challenges, that sort of stuff. They're just absolutely the best characters that you can do. The raid's a little bit different because you need certain characters to be doing certain things. We can talk about the raid later. I can put together a raid guide. I have some thoughts and some of that sort of stuff on a raid guide, and I'm going to be doing that later. But when we're talking about tower and arena, right, these eight characters are plug and play, put them wherever you want, and they're really, really good. So without spending too much more time, let's get into the characters. But I think it's important to understand where I'm coming from, why these characters are as good. But let's talk about Nidiel. Nidiel's the MVP. Absolutely, hands down, the MVP right now. She's the reason why is that she, of course, by herself, she does a lot of really, really good things. For example, she removes debuffs from herself and Solius, and buffs from the random enemy at the start of turn, and then two of them if Solius is on the battlefield. But even without Solius, she still removes buffs, and a lot of times she's removing taunts from tanks. This makes her amazing. Another big one is her Midnight Glow ability. All allies gain increased damage is amazing in its first turn. Right out of the gate, she can do that. Her second ability, Veil of Silence, is her first special, right? 420% of her magic damage and ability block for two turns. It's really, really good. And then, of course, Moon and Stars has a 50% chance to deal damage through the shields, and that's really well done as well. But she shines because she can give everybody damage up. She can remove buffs from the other team, and right, she does a ton of damage, single target damage, and she can be relatively quick. She's not fast. She's not a fast character. You know, her base speed is not particularly fast, but she can become relatively fast and be really good. She's my only gear 10 character that I have at the present moment, but she is phenomenal. Let's talk about Kara. Kara is great by herself. She is amazing. Once again, she can plug and play into any character. She can make orcs better. She can make PvP team in tournaments better. She makes everything better. I wish that I had her at gear 9. I don't right now. I'm just kind of behind on the gear crunch, but she is phenomenal, right? She can do ability block on her basic. She has an AoE that dazes. Right, she gives turn meter to your entire team. Right, she gains visibility, she gains counterattack to the tanks, and she can restore 25% of all turn meter on the battlefield. And then if Venomate's there, she gives him haste. But without Venomate, she's great by herself. She does not need Venomate to be good, and I think everybody knows that. And then, of course, her sudden attack ability. If she's invisible, her attacks deal 30% more damage. And then Venomate also gets this ability. So, 30% more damage when invisible? Heck yeah. You team that up with Nightingale, and you're going to be doing tons and tons of damage. But once again, you can plug and play her anywhere in the game. You can plug her in with Soleus and Nightingale. You can plug her in with other teams, you know, with orcs. You can plug her in with pandas if you really wanted to. You could plug her in with Patriarch Chi and Ken Lee. Give Ken Lee the ability to counterattack and that sort of thing. So, I mean, she's just an amazing character right now, and I think that you can understand why. Next, Soleus. I know Soleus is a legendary character. People may not have him because either you're new to the game or you didn't get him the first time around, but he's the best healer in the game. By far the best healer in the game. His heal does 550% of his magic damage. His magic damage can be buffed up huge. He's got passive abilities that gives cheat death to humans and healers and tacticians. And of course to Nightingale as well. Human fighters receive potency ups. A lot of really, really good synergy there. And of course his leadership is pretty good, decent, but what makes him shine are his first three abilities. He deals damage. Nightingale then is summoned to attack. And then he also gives 20% chance to restore a random turn to someone else, which is really, really good. And then his second heal heals an ally for 40% of their max health, applies armor increase, tenacity increase, haste, damage increase, and cheat death for 2 turns. It's absolutely phenomenal. He can plug and play, right? You could just put him into any lineup and he's going to be phenomenal as just your healer. So, as you can see. Freezard. Once again, Freezard. If you're new to the game, if you're brand new to this game and you're just starting to play this, they offer you a Freezard pack. Buy it. You need to buy that. As you can see with Freezard, I need to put speed on him. I'm currently lacking in that department. But he is a he has synergy with Snorri, but even then you don't necessarily need that. Where he shines in is his first three abilities: Blizzard, ability to remove turn meter and do damage 220% of his magic damage to all enemies. That's amazing. All right. His Frost Breath, 220 damage, magic damage to 3 enemies, and a 50% chance to inflict armor decrease. Right, all on his own, he can do these sorts of things. He inflicts slow and 230% of magic damage. Right, And then, of course, he's hard to kill. He survives a fatal blow. He has a built-in cheat death. And if Freezard recovers 10% health all the way down, if you have it all the way down, he recovers 25% of his health, and it only triggers once per battle. And he has stuff for, you know, with Snorri. But he has synergy with Snorri. But you don't need Snorri for him to be phenomenal. You just don't. He does really well on his own. And then Mr. Trumgar. Trumgar is the best tank in the game. There may be some argument to that when you get into the later game. Obviously, you have, but I think as a standalone character by himself, you can plug and play him in a lot of situations. And he has a stun on his basic, right? 35% chance to stun on his basic. He can taunt first turn, which is really, really great. He can heal himself and remove 3 debuffs or all of the debuffs on him if you have it maxed out, which I do not. He gains a bunch, 30% more defense and 30% increased damage when he's in flipping his stances. And then as a leader, he has a great leadership if you want to go straight orcs without Rantha, and he can make for a great orc leader, especially teamed up with with Hard Orc and Corcrum. So, and then we get to Wonder Lula. Wonder Lula is the last character on the list, and the reason why she does make this list still, even after being nerfed, is that you don't need anyone to make her work. She is going to do a lot of damage all on her own. She does 20% extra damage, and you get 7% more for each demon in the party, so she's going to be good about countering Venomate and Kara, right? She gains invisibility. She can give invisibility to herself, and she can do that relatively quickly. And then, of course, she does great damage on piercing shot, and when she's invisible, it's a guaranteed critical, right? And it also penetrates shields. I think half of the damage now penetrates shields, and the other half hits the shields. I would have liked to have seen that ability continue to penetrate shields, but I understand why it doesn't. If you've seen my other video on Wonder Lula, she still one-shots people at gear 11. So I understand why they did that. And then Wonder Shot, has a pretty good, decent basic. But as a single target DPS, she does very, very well. But she's lower than, say, Kara or Nighty Elf for DPS, because she doesn't have any other utility. She basically, outside of stealthing, she doesn't really do anything else, but she does put out a good bit of damage still. And so that's important. It's important to understand that as a damage dealer, as a single target damage dealer, she's right up there, but she's not giving damage up to anyone. She's not dazing or stunning or doing ability blocks like Kara, and she's not giving counter attack. So that's what makes her, but she's still in my opinion, the right there at the bottom of the tier one list, because she can be, she can be plugged and played in immediately. And so that's my top tier list of the top 8 characters currently that can be plugged and played anywhere. They're viable in almost all situations, in tournaments, into PvP, and that sort of stuff. Really, really, really good. Very, very well done. If you have questions, if you disagree with me, that's perfectly fine. Put your comments down. I will certainly read your comments and go through them. If you like what I had, please drop a like on the video. It does help out a lot. Hit that subscribe button. Hit that notifications bell. There will be another video coming out about talking about tier 2 and what I constitute as tier 2 and tier 3 and tier 4 abilities. And then we'll talk about the raid as well, and we're gonna go through those will be coming out in subsequent days. So today, if you're watching this on Sunday the 24th of November, then the next video is going to come out Monday, and I'll have videos coming out Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. So today, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, talking about the different tiers and that sort of stuff. I'm going to release them in order, and so, like I said, if I really hope you guys enjoyed the video or the whole series about what the different tier lists are. But these are the top eight. This is the tier one. These are the best characters, I believe, for plugging and playing into anything. They may not necessarily make the best team or the best or that sort of thing. That's not what we're trying to do. However, I am currently running them in Arena. And I am ranked 18 at the moment, and that is the team that I am currently running. So let's go ahead and end the video here. I will go ahead and let's see if I'll just run real quick a quick match with the team that I am using in the arena, which is consistent of the top characters in my opinion, minus Wonder Lula. Minus Hard Orc. Oh, and I forgot to mention Hard Orc. I apologize. We'll have to go back and do that real quick. I just realized that Hard Orc is also... Now, I know a lot of people aren't going to have him, but he's a great plug-and-play character as well. So let's go... I'll go ahead and talk about Hard Orc real quick while we're doing the battle, because I don't want the video to be too much longer. But Hard Orc is also the top, the last one, and I apologize. I have to go back in. Gone back in now and edited Hard Orc back in there. I have to go ahead and do that. With Hard Orc, he's an amazing character. He does a good bit of damage. He has ability block. He has so many things that he has to offer. Different characters, different abilities. The ability to ability block everyone, the ability to cast cheat death. Now it's slower. It's certainly slower, and that's kind of what's what the problem is for him. As you can see, we're struggling here a little bit. It'll be okay. Should have been paying more attention to the battle and instead of talking, but it'll be all right. So, as we can get, we'll go ahead and power up a Night EL here. There we go. So, yeah, we'll have to go in and put Hard Orc in here in a second. I think that he's one of those characters that not a lot of people are going to have, and so it's a little difficult to gauge him. But I think that... As you can see, they're all synergizing quite well together, and we end up winning the match. But let's talk about Hard Orc real quick. I apologize. Give me just a second here. All right. So, sorry about that. Kind of a post-edit. I kind of forgot. I forgot Hard Orc. Went through and forgot that he was there. And I happened to realize that I didn't talk about him. And so we needed to go ahead and put him on in there. So let's go ahead and do that real quick. And Patriarch Chi. So I said there was eight characters. I did Wonder Lula, but I didn't do Patriarch Chi, and I didn't do Hard Orc. And so I apologize, but Patriarch Chi is the best leader in the game. He can be plugged and played. He does some great things as a leader. If you don't have him, he is amazing for tower, but he's a good standalone character. You can just throw him in. Throw him in as a lead. He does a great job. And so I think that mainly does with his leadership and his heal ability, his shield ability, which are huge. And then Hard Orc, of course, as we talked kind of when I was doing the PvP battle, right? His ability, Devil's Horned, which gives cheat death regeneration damage increase to four allies for two turns, is amazing. He's kind of slow, but he can, to get there, it takes a long time to get to this ability. It's got a cooldown of four. And then Power Solo, the ability block, they can hit everybody on the team. That's really, really good. And then it can last, if you have it maxed to six, which I don't currently have, it'll actually be a two-turn ability block. And then his basic does inflicts bleed. And so that's kind of where he's at here. And he also removed debuffs from random allies. All the way, he can remove a actually one debuff off of four random allies when he's at maxed out. So he's just a great utility character, but he can be plugged and played anywhere. So I apologize for the video being as long as it was. I should have been a little bit better about that. But those are the eight top characters in the game. I do hope you enjoyed what we talked about here today. If you did like the video, please hit that subscribe button, hit that notifications bell, hit that like button, and we'll see you next time when gaming and the law intersect.